Welcome to our gathering this afternoon. How good to see you all. Hope you've come with your biggest, bravest voices. We want to hear you today. Let me pray for us, and then we'll begin our time together. Jesus, we want to thank you that there is nowhere in your universe that we can go where you aren't. And so as a consequence of that big, big reality, we want to thank you for being here in this small corner of everything you have created. You are present, and we are able to connect with you. So, Father, we ask for that miracle this afternoon, that we would catch another glimpse of you, be drawn closer to you, and be more of all the things that you have created us to be and desire us to be. May you open our eyes and our hearts through these words, through everything that goes on here. May you draw us closer to you. In Jesus' precious name, amen. Phil is here, our brand new pastor, which is wonderful. Oh, he's a month old. That's right. Phil is going to be our preacher today, so it's worth sticking around. One of the most beloved of all hymns, of course, is All Creatures of Our God and King. And these words were initially written by St. Francis of Assisi, so they're actually one of the oldest hymns that we continue to sing around the world today. They come from his Canticle of the Sun poem, and they're based on Psalm 148. So I'm told that it's always a good way to start a service with scripture. So maybe we'll just take a moment now to let Psalm 148 just flow over you. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord from the heavens. Praise him from the skies. Praise him, all his angels. Praise him, all the armies of heaven. Praise him, sun and moon. Praise him, all you twinkling stars. Praise him, skies above. Praise him, vapors high above the clouds. Let every created thing give praise to the Lord, for he issued his command and they came into being. He set them in place forever and ever. His decree will never be revoked. Praise the Lord from the earth, you creatures of the ocean depths, fire and hail, snow and clouds, wind and weather that obey him. Mountains and all hills, fruit trees and all cedars, wild animals and all livestock, small scurrying animals and birds, kings of the earth and all people, rulers and judges of the earth, young men and young women, old men and children. Let them all praise the name of the Lord, for his name is very great. His glory towers over the earth and heaven. He has made his people strong, honoring his faithful ones, the people of Israel who are close to him. Praise the Lord. So please stand if you are able, and we'll sing together this celebration of both creation and the Creator. Please stand. Thank you.
next hymn is Count Your Blessings. It's a favorite gospel hymn, and it simply tells us, it's a reminder of the many blessings of God that he gives us, even during hard times. It's a reminder too, as people who trust in Jesus, all things are working for our good, and we are always abundantly blessed. Johnson Oatman lived between 1856 and 1922. During his lifetime, he wrote lyrics of over 5,000 gospel songs and hymns. A large number of these songs are still sung within the church today. And Count Your Blessings is probably the best loved of all of them. We'll sing.
It's a song that we've been singing a lot lately. Find great comfort in it. Please join me in prayer. Our Father, when we pause to count our blessings, first of all, we praise you that you sent your Son Jesus into this world, that in him you showed us yourself, and we see what you're like, a wonderful, caring Father. That he died on the cross, taking our place and opening the way for us to know you personally. And Father, whatever other blessing we may reckon, these are the greatest, and for them we praise you. And we praise you for the gift of your Holy Spirit. We praise you for the fact that he is in us and he is with us every moment of every day. And Father, as we think about these things, it makes us sad that so often we forget these things, that so often we try to live life in our own strength, so often we try to live it alone, as it were. Forgive us, please, and help us ever to look to you, to realize your love and your care and your presence, and to take great delight in it. And thank you, our Father, that through Jesus we have forgiveness. But Father God, as we think about our own situation in life, we are of a generation and a country who have been blessed so much. And it makes me uncomfortable sometimes that there are people in this world doing it so tough. And just now we pray particularly for people in Ukraine and ask you, our Lord and our Father, to bring this war to an end, to give peace to those people, to give them their lives back, and somehow ease their grief. And there are other people around the world suffering just as much. We don't hear about them to the same degree. We bring them to you too and ask you to make your presence very real to them so that they can find comfort in you. And Father, there's so many other things for which we would pray. We pray for our own country, for our new government, for wisdom for these leaders to know how to manage things and just what to do with the various challenges at the present time. And then, Father, we focus in on this church. And we thank you that you have brought Phil and Karen to this church. We thank you for the depth of experience they bring and the love for you that they bring, and we ask your blessing on them, that they will bless this church in a mighty way. And Father, we pray now for ourselves, our own particular needs, and we take a moment now individually to bring these needs to you. Father, we know that you hear us. We know that you know what's best. And we trust you to do the best for each one of us. In Jesus' name. Amen.
A Bible reading this afternoon from Luke. Chapter 5. Later, as Jesus left the town, he saw a tax collector named Levi sitting at his tax collector's booth. "Follow me and be my disciple," Jesus said to him, "So Levi got up, left everything, and followed him." Later, Levi held a banquet in his home with Jesus as the guest of honor. Many of Levi's fellow tax collectors and other guests also ate with them. But the Pharisees and their religious teachers of the law complained bitterly to Jesus' disciples, "Why do you eat and drink with such scum?" Jesus answered them, "Healthy people need a doctor. Sick people don't. I have come to call not those who think that they are righteous, but those who know that they are sinners and need to repent." One day, some people said to Jesus, "John the Baptist's disciples fast and pray regularly. So do the disciples of the Pharisees. Why are your disciples always eating and drinking?" Jesus responded, "Do wedding guests fast while celebrating with the groom? Of course not. But someday, the groom will be taken from them. Then they will fast." And Jesus gave them this illustration. No one tears a piece of cloth from a new garment to use it to patch an old garment, for then the new garment would be ruined and the new patch wouldn't even match the old garment. No one puts new wine into old wineskin, for the new wine would burst the wineskin, spilling the wine and ruining the skins. New wine must be stored in new wineskins. But no one who drinks the old wine seems to want the new wine. The old wine is just fine, they say. Mark's going to introduce the next song.
"Is Your All on the Altar" is a song encouraging us to dedicate our entire lives to the Lord, that we might be servants of Christ and do the will of God from the heart. The text and tune were both composed by Elisha Albright Hoffman, and we have no other information concerning this hymn, and even that, despite that we know nothing about it, it has become remarkably well known as a call to give ourselves wholly to God. If you would like to stand, you are welcome. We'll sing, "Is Your All on the Altar."
Your heart Hands up, everyone who had never heard that hymn before. Ah, good, I'm not alone. They say that mad dogs and Canberrans go out in the winter rain. I don't think there'd be anyone here this morning. You're a hardy lot in this town, yes. It's great to be here, getting to know names slowly, and please don't be at all afraid to reintroduce yourself every time you meet me for a while. And if you don't have your actual photo in the church database, there'll be a $50 fine per week that your photo is not updated. The office will be sending out the bills. So, I wanted to share, quite frankly, with you today, because we're still getting to know each other, and I want to share what for me is one of the biggest challenges of pastoral leadership. And I may end up earning your sympathy, I may end up earning your derision, but I also want to involve you in the same dilemma, actually, so be careful. I will confess that I have always found change difficult. I have still not forgiven Westpac Bank for dropping the old logo with the emu and the kangaroo from the Bank of New South Wales. And this is taxing your memory, isn't it? It was a magnificent logo, and I think some American graphic artists got involved, and we now have a red W. Things like that irritate me for life. I don't like change, especially when it's change which is not for the better. But generally, I struggle with change altogether. I've got a few pictures just of a little. We could give 10,000 examples of this, couldn't we? I can remember as a boy, it was my job to get, well, I was young enough that I had to pull a chair out from the kitchen table so I could reach up onto the top of the fridge and turn on the radio for Mum and Dad to listen to what? Of course, every lunchtime. And I miss a family gathered around, not Blue Hills, I don't miss that. I tell you what I do miss is, Green Bottle and, Yes, Sir, thank you, yes. The hours our family spent, do you know what I'm talking about, Mike? No, you don't? Okay. It was a humorous skit on Australian radio for many years running, and it was very funny. And those family times are very special, and there's really nothing equivalent to that. I miss that change. But what do we go to? What's the next slide? Now, remember these? I can remember the day our family got its direct drive turntable, thank you. Not a belt-driven one like those old ones. We were just the cutting edge of technology in our house when we got our first direct drive turntable. And I miss records. I still occasionally go into shops and buy, they still make them, of course, records. They're somewhat back in vogue. And, to be able to pick up an album cover and look at the presentation by the group of what it is that they're, not just their music, but their visual images and so forth, and theme on the album. I miss that. I don't change easy. What's the next one? We went from them to those cassette things, and that was the pinnacle, wasn't it? I can remember, but late at night in bed with the light out, listening to the radio with my finger on the record button. And you'd listen to the first note of the new song, yes, I want that one, and you would start to record. And you were so annoyed if before the song ended, the DJ started talking over the end music, because that would ruin your tape on the cassette. But that was just the pinnacle of music for me as a teenager, recording songs to a cassette tape. But then that gave way to CDs. And how amazing was that? An entire album I'm talking CD, not DVD. Yeah, they weren't around yet. An entire album could fit on that little aluminium disc. And you could even play it in your car, as long as you weren't on too bumpy a road. Then it got rather problematic. But we struggled with that new technology. Anyone still got a CD player you use at your home? Yeah, I tell you what, I'd get a different response if I asked that question on Sunday night at the youth. They'd go, what? What? You're showing your generation there, I'm afraid. Because what is it these days? Well, no, it's not even that anymore, you know. They've stopped making these, or they're just about to run them out. That they made the announcement that they were ceasing production. I'm not sure of the exact date. The iPod, which could fit hundreds of songs in your pockets and then thousands of songs in your pocket, is also yesterday's news. How quickly does change sweep over us? And I can remember the day that Steve Jobs did his, or the week that Steve Jobs did his one more thing, and he held up the iPhone and showed all of the iPod software in the iPhone. I went, they have just made redundant their top-selling product ever. I just so admire a company that can be the one that says there's a better idea, we'll be the ones who destroy our own product. And they're a thing of the past now. So what is it these days? Isn't it good to hold your music? But, you know, there it is. So I can sort of go, okay, let me think. What's something that would be applicable here to a generation here? Let me go. I've got one. So I'm just thinking of this, and how long does it take me to find it? Right, here we go. We'll play that. All right, it's coming through. How do I get that to change? Do you know what's happening, by the way? It's coming through my hearing aids. Yes. And I can hear it and you can't. This is what happens. Sound I'll need. So you go to do some clever high-tech thing, and I have no idea how to get my phone to play to you. George Bev Shea is singing How Great Thou Art, okay? He's singing it very well, you just can't hear it. And I'd better stop him or I won't be able to hear anything else for the rest of the day. So how long did that take me? 10 seconds? And you name the artist and I'll have them playing. It's straight out of the cloud. It's really that much at our fingertips these days. But I miss the old ways. How can I possibly miss climbing up on a chair? Well, I wouldn't have to do that these days. I'm a bit taller. But turning on the family radio. How can I miss that when I can call up George Bevshow? Any other artist that you can name and have them singing my favourite song within 10 seconds. So it's that conundrum, isn't it, that you can't turn back change, and it's good, but there is that within me that struggles with these things. Well, that's what our reading today is, by the way. And I would say that the issue of change in our modern world is perhaps one of the most difficult things that pastors have to deal with. So I can remember, like, how do you communicate with the church? Tell me how you do that. I can tell you how I used to do it. How do you communicate to the people in the church today?
Face-to-face.
Well, you're assuming they come to church to be seen face-to-face. Why aren't they sitting at home watching the, because a great significant number can be. Yeah, I know the way I like it. I'm talking about the way you can do it. So I can remember standing with my father and getting ink all over my fingers, churning the Gestetner machine, and that was the way you communicated with your church. Now, we still kind of have a bulletin, don't we, bits and pieces. It's in electronic format. Do you really think anyone under the age of 20 reads that? Because I don't. Well, maybe a lot of people a lot older than the age of 20 don't read it either. So do you use Facebook? Oh, that's brilliant for people over 30. How many of you are on, some of the other, I won't even kind of think of the names of the apps that they're on and so forth. Instagram, there's one, but it's only one of five or six. So how do you get your message out? Well, you have to communicate across multiple platforms. Gee, that's fun. What a great idea. The world is a better place. This is what changes and what the dilemma of pastoral ministry is. But even more seriously, what changes good and what changes not good? So let's have a look at this passage, because it's really dealing with exactly this issue. After this, Jesus went out, he saw the tax collector, the Levi, sitting at his booth, and follow me, he says. And of course, there's a whole story between the fact that Levi did get up and follow him, but we won't go there today. And the first thing that Levi did before he physically left the area was to throw a party to introduce Jesus to his friends. And, I like the way the New Living Translation puts it, he met with the scum. What I sort of put down was, it's very difficult to us to think, we don't have an equivalent to tax collectors really these days. But perhaps it was a party of pornographic film industry executives or something like that, right? These are not people. You are genuinely revolted by what they do and who they are, okay? This is not, oh, I'm just better than you. This is people going, those people are, they're abusers, they're traitors, they're, self-seeking at the expense of people who are in poverty. They're genuinely scum. And Jesus eats with them. He eats with them. So the Pharisees and the teachers of the law come and complain to Jesus' disciples while this is happening. Why are you doing this? Why? And Jesus, hearing this, answers them and says, well, it's not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. I've not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance, which is a fantastic answer. Does it surprise you that that's a good answer? What I'm amazed by in the New Testament is they keep lining up to debate Jesus. Honestly, talk about being on a hiding to nothing. He absolutely always nails the answer, and this is a great one. But although the appropriate response would be to say, yes, very well spoken, thank you, please continue, they don't. They come up with an inappropriate response, and they say, look, John the Baptist, even his disciples fast and pray, as do we Pharisees. But yours are just going on eating and drinking. So what's behind this? What's behind this is the tradition and this is the way and this is something new you're doing and we are struggling with it. I am sympathetic with the Pharisees. I'm often sympathetic with the Pharisees, by the way. We misread the Pharisees in the New Testament. Probably of all the Jewish non-followers of Jesus, they were the closest. In fact, I don't know if you've ever seen the chart. I might make it up, redig it up. Have you ever seen the chart of a description between Baptists and Pharisees? Oh, you haven't seen it? Let me give it to you, just the ones that's still on the top of my head. Strong passion for the lost. A care for the poor. Really revere and read scripture. Believe in prayer. Spiritual disciplines like fasting. You think you're so different? We're not. We really do come from a very similar theological strain as the Pharisees. They hadn't yet discovered Jesus. That's a pretty big one. But it's interesting that at the Council of Jerusalem, who are they addressing as they debate the issues within the Christian church? Christian Pharisees. So many of them actually came over into the church as well. It was that close. So when you read about the Pharisees, don't put them in the really bad guy category. Now, these are people who are close to us and really struggling. That's often the case. Doesn't mean Jesus didn't sometimes lash them, but that's okay. And so they said, John's disciples often fast and pray, so do we. And Jesus says, can you make the guests of the bridegroom fast while he's with you? In other words, there's times when fasting is appropriate. There's times for tradition. There's times for what you're doing. And there are times where it's not appropriate. And you've got the tradition wrong today, says Jesus. You know, it's interesting that fasting regularly is actually not a prescribed Old Testament thing. There's Leviticus 23 and Numbers 29, when, for instance, they had to fast on the Day of Atonement and so forth. But what the Pharisees had done at some point to enhance their spiritual life was they'd started the practice of fasting on the second day of the week and also on the fifth day of the week. Do you know why the second day of the week and the fifth day of the week? We don't know our Old Testament as well as the Pharisees, you see. They're ahead of us in that regard. Second day of the week was when Moses went up the mountain. The fifth day of the week was when Moses came down the mountain. Okay? So it's we'll fast on those days. Now, I am sure that the people who came up with that tradition did it as a spiritual discipline and with a purity of heart to get closer to God. So was it a bad tradition? No, of course not. But it's almost become a law now, you see, for a righteous person in the Pharisees' eyes to do this. So that the ritual has become a tradition which is almost compulsory, and to show that you're more religious and devoted than other people. By Jesus' time, the Pharisees would often go and put ash from the fire on their faces to make them look pale and sickly, and they'd put on rough clothes of sackcloth or hessian. Some would even suck in their cheeks to show how long they'd been fasting. And doesn't look like I've been fasting, so that's not going to work. But you know what they meant. And Jesus condemns them in Matthew 6:16. When you fast, do not look somber as the hypocrites do, for they disfigure their faces to show men they are fasting. I tell you the truth, they've received their reward in full. That's all they're going to get for that. But when you fast, put oil on your face and wash your face so that it will not be obvious to men that you're fasting, but only to your Father who is unseen, and your Father who sees what's done in secret will reward you. But in this passage, Jesus just goes, how inappropriate are you? Why would you fast when the bridegroom is here? Your tradition doesn't fit this situation, he's saying to them. And I've certainly got the hindsight to have reflected on that and go, Jesus is right, they're wrong, that one's easy. That one's easy. What about all the others we've got to decide on? Because sometimes in our church, we've got traditions which are just inappropriate for the time. Music's one of them, isn't it? How good is it to come and sing these songs? Why isn't this place packed? I honestly don't know, right? Because we recognise good music when we hear it, don't we? We're just really saying, naming which generation we're from, aren't we? I mean, I had the experience of being rebuked last year by my associate at Springwood's wife. And she was absolutely right, because she had heard me say how that week I had sat down with Netflix and I was there to watch the musical Hamilton. How many people here have seen Hamilton? Boy, this is generational, isn't it? One, two, yep. If I asked that of the young people, how many do you think they would see that, right? Anyway, I don't know whether you've tried to listen to Hamilton. It's sort of roughly based off rap music. And I wasn't ready for that. I wanted Les Mis. I wanted orchestras and fantastic songs and operatic class singers and music to sing to myself with. And all it is they're chanting out this story. Just didn't get it at all. And so I'd let rip in this conversation about what a dumb musical it was. And my associate's wife, Skye, said, you're wrong. It's an incredibly emotional musical. It had me in tears. You missed it. You've got to go back and listen to it and stop trying to hear Les Mis, hear Hamilton. It's a different, more modern musical style. I haven't done it yet, but I promised myself I will force myself to do it, because she was clearly right. I'm just locked into my generation's conception of what a great musical is, and it ain't Hamilton, I can tell you that. It'll never be in my great musical category. But it's swept the world. There'll be more of them. So we've got to be able to recognise, haven't we? And I'm not telling you anything here. Am I the only one here struggling with any of these things? No, of course I'm not. I'm talking to the converted, I know that. But it's a matter of, where is this the right time? And Jesus was saying, particularly within the church, of course, the time for fasting is not when he was with them. That was a time for celebration. And there's all sorts of traditions in church, isn't there? What about men can't wear a hat to church? You know the funny one? Our generation only saw the very tail back end of that tradition. Do you know what that really is all about? Men should not be out in public without a hat on their head. If you go back to your great-great-great-great-great-grandparents, they would have been almost as embarrassed to see a man in public without a hat as a man in public without pants on. Kid you not. Read some of the old literature. The expressions of embarrassment and we must provide for this person, their head is bare. But of course, when you came to a building, then the women had to wear the hat, particularly in church, and the men at that point took their hat off. I think quite serious misinterpretations of Corinthians, but that's all right. It was just part of the tradition. But we never saw that, did we? Our generation just went, oh, men don't. And do you know where that still, by the way, is the case? It's not so much in church anymore. Did you know that that is still a rule in part of our culture? Does anyone know where? I wasn't aware of the RSL. I was going to say the golf club. If you finish a game of golf and you leave your golf hat on and you go into the clubhouse, you won't get 10 steps before you're reprimanded and asked to take your hat off. So it's funny how these traditions hang on in some place. They're hanging on there even more than in church, because I don't think anyone would reprimand anyone who wore a golf hat to church or anything these days. But they hang on within our culture. And we're often not even really sure what the historical background to them was. We just know that that's the tradition. Then Jesus goes on. And to further reinforce the point, he tells two parables. The one about the old cloth and patch the new one. Well, I would say who patches anything these days anyway? It's a standing joke whenever I get a hole in a sock at my house that I want Karen to darn my sock. She's never darned one of my socks yet, let me tell you. But I complain every time that standards have dropped and that no longer do the socks get darned. Because we just don't do that anymore, but the imagery still works, doesn't it? You wouldn't take an old cloth and patch. Sorry, which way around is it? That way. Thank you. You wouldn't mismatch the cloths, that's the point. And then, of course, there's the wineskins, isn't there? And, no one pours new wine into old wineskins. If he does, the new wine will burst the skins, wine will run out, and the skins will be burnt. That was actually because the wine did much of its fermenting in the goat skin that they would sew up. And so therefore, if it was a new goat skin, it had flex and stretch. And as the wine fermented and so forth, you were okay. But do that with a skin that had already stretched and become brittle. And, it's a little bit like our family went through a stage where my older brother was making ginger beer from a plant. And for safety, he would store those ginger beer bottles under the house, which meant that several times we woke up to fireworks in the middle of the night as those bottles would have fermented to too high a degree. And even the glass, or not so much the glass, would break after the top was blown off it sort of thing. It was a very similar process with the wineskins. That was their process. So it just clearly was, you don't mix the old with the new in inappropriate ways, is what Jesus was saying. And again, yes, Jesus, I understand the parable. It's self-evident that some things don't fit. But when do we know? How do we know when the situations are, when change is necessary and when it's not? I think it's the classic leadership dilemma, and probably not just within churches, but leadership in any organisation, within your own working lives, whatever you're involved in, much the same issue would come along. But the point is that old religious constructs, Jesus is saying, of traditions and rituals that can't cope with the dynamic energy of the new covenant of God and the thing that God is doing in a different way, that God's purposes can't be confined within the old religion of Judaism. I like old ways. I thought Billy Graham had a good formula going. It worked. Apparently back in the 50s, I wasn't alive then. Certainly remember it working well in the 70s. Do you think we should do that again? Do you think that will work? If we pitched a tent and invited an evangelist to come, and would we rock the society like we did back then? Probably not. That wineskin has changed on us, isn't it? So again, that's an easy one. But what about the new ideas that we hear? We like to think of ourselves as being quite traditional Baptist, I think. Do you know that it used to be the custom for every service that while the preacher preached, there was a row of chairs behind the preacher or even in front of the preacher, and the deacons would sit and face the congregation while the preacher preached. And as they were looking at the congregation, they would be making notes on who was there and who's not and what they knew about people, and then people would be called to account at the end of the service. Why don't we try it on Sunday? Don't you think that'd be a good idea? I think our people would really like that, wouldn't they? And verse 39 is an interesting one. Actually, the New Living Translation, I think, makes it a little bit easy in what it says in verse 39. Where am I? New wine must be put in old wineskins. No one who drinks the old wine seems to want the fresh and the new. The old is better, they say. That does explain it very clearly, and I think that's the right interpretation. The NIV and others just go, the old is better, which makes you think, what's Jesus saying? Is he saying that the old ways are really better? But I think that's the correct way to translate it. Jesus is actually saying old wine is always better to those who are drinkers of wine, right? Those who know about these things, I don't really know about that. I've got a son who's right into wine culture and what's good and what's bad, and he talks a language I don't even understand. But apparently old wine is better than new wine. I've got that much. And we want to hang on to that which is great music. I want to hang on to it as much as anyone else does, and there are appropriate ways to do that, which is good. But when are the inappropriate ways? How do we know what it is to pull in and pull out? We're going to be facing that over the next few years. I don't have a single example of that come to mind yet. I'm not standing up here with an agenda of I've got some ideas I'm going to hit you with or anything like that. Nothing like that. I wouldn't have a clue what's going to happen over the next few years. But I'm pretty sure there'll be change. And you can know that I'm going to be struggling with it. And you can know that I will be agonizing about whether it's the right thing to do and whether it's the time. But here's the thing. Have you ever seen young people complain about change? It's always us. We are the generation who holds the keys. It's a great responsibility, isn't it? It's not just the pastors. It's all of us. So whenever we come to say, what is it that that is changed that we need to do, there's got to be a couple of ways, I think, in which I have to ask myself, what are the guiding principles that I'm going to use to get through this? They're not complicated, because I'm not very complicated. One is, does it honour or dishonour Christ? So if the change is simply something which is, you know, not building people up or dishonouring God in some way, then that's easy. There's nothing to argue about there. But the other one is, you know, is it for me or is it for the kingdom, this change? Because if it was for me, things would be a lot different, or I'd be pushing for a lot more than I do. But to have the wisdom to know this is for the kingdom. I remember when I got to Springwood, I stood up and said, understand that when I might recommend any changes to the church, it will always be the question of what is best for the mission of the kingdom rather than what is best for us. And they all went, yeah, that's great. And a month later, I changed the evening service time. It was a predominantly youth and young adult service, and we changed it to 5 o'clock, to 6 o'clock, because it was meeting at 7 o'clock, and I wanted them to be able to socialise after the service and have a meal and whatever. So can you imagine how delighted I was when I came here and found out that our young people's evening service is at 5 o'clock, and guess what they do afterwards? They go out for tea. But even that, I agonized over, because you've got people who are used to this time. And I actually had some people in that congregation at 6 o'clock who could no longer make it at 5 because they had various commitments. And so they came to me and said, well, I can't make it if you make this change. And I went, that's right, you come to the morning service, you'll be fine. Not doing it for you. So you can have some principles sometimes that help you. But what I'm saying is, it is we. I'm including myself in your generation. Some of you are probably looking at me and still saying, you're young, Phil. I get that. But let me tell you, when I get to Everett at the 5 p.m. service and I stand up there, they don't see a difference between you and me. You're over 60, you're just over 60. There's no numbers after that sort of thing, you know. It just all blurs together. And we are a generation that very much we hold the keys for this church. Sometimes I think older people go, oh, nobody listens to me. And as a pastor, I can tell you that is not true. The number of times I've seen young people rocked, full of enthusiasm, and then some older person in a church grumbles, complains, says something negative toward them, they hear it. We need to be careful how we say things to younger people. But we also need to give our wisdom to younger people, because we do have it. And sometimes they can make suggestions that are not wholesome, not good for community, not we've seen it before. And we're right to say, no, I don't think so. But we also need to be a generation that... all my life I've played this game, which is I've watched older people in each church I've went, and I've gone, I want to be like you, and I don't want to be like you. Have you done that? You know that those older people that age with grace and humility and are still open to a world of change, even if they don't like it like I don't? I do want to be like that. I don't want to be some grumbling... I remember we went on a holiday to New Zealand once, and on the third day my children went out and bought me a t-shirt that said Grumpy Old Man on it. And I thought, oh, I've really got to change. I got the message. I don't want to be that. I want to be those people who age graciously, who encourage the younger people of this church, who hold the future in their hands, don't they, in so many ways. But I just wanted to share that with you, that if you think that pastoral leadership is, what is the most difficult thing about it? I would say these days it's that. So many changes that just come and come and come and seem ever faster. And we don't have some sort of insight into what's right or wrong or will work or not work any more than anyone else, really. And it's the difficulty of leadership to sort of go, where is God in this? This is something we open ourselves up to. All my life I've dreaded that church music would turn into rap music, because I have never tolerated rap music. And it still may. It may still be coming. And will I have the graciousness when it comes to go, I'll survive on Sunday, Tuesday afternoon once a month by gathering, singing real music. And I mean, I'm not that bad. I'm of a generation that also likes rock. And, you know, most of us these days are of the Beatles generation, really, aren't we? And we have the ability more than a previous generation to us did to adjust to some of these things. But the young people always come up with new things. And to know what the wisdom is with the new wine is a thing that with great humility we need to come before God and go, is this it, Lord? Should we be doing this one? So I'm always open to you coming and knocking on my door and going, let's talk about wineskins, Phil. And I always appreciate insight as to whether they're new or old, appropriate or not appropriate, and what the future might hold for us. It's a great responsibility we hold as a generation. We will be the permission givers for the younger people in this church over the next 10, 20, 30 years. And that's a great responsibility that God gives us. So with humility and with grace, let's ask the Spirit to guide us in that one together. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for Jesus, who saw things so clearly. Lord, how I wish I could run each situation by him and get direct answers like the disciples did in these situations. Though perhaps, Lord, the answers would be ones that I struggle with just as much as the dilemma. And we just pray that you might help us to recognize when your Spirit is at work and what it is that you are blessing. Our prayer, Lord, is that you help us do what you are blessing, not, please, Lord, bless what we're doing. Give us the wisdom to know the difference, that we might be a blessing as the older, elder, wiser generation in this church, that we might be the ones who are able to say, this is the way. This way leads to the kingdom of God and the glory of God. Help us in this situation, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, that leads us very nicely into our next hymn. And the next hymn is Have Thine Own Way, Lord. In 1902, Adelaide Pollard was hoping to go to Africa as a missionary, but found herself unable to raise the funds to make the journey. Greatly discouraged, she attended a prayer service one evening, and as she sat there, she overheard an elderly woman say, "It really doesn't matter what you do with us, Lord. Just have your own way in our lives." Pollard was inspired and contemplated the story of the potter from Jeremiah 18, which reads, "The Lord gave another message to Jeremiah. He said, 'Go down to the potter's shop and I will speak to you there.' So I did as he told me and found the potter working at his wheel. But the jar he was making did not turn out as he had hoped. So he crushed it into a lump of clay again and started over. Then the Lord gave me this message, 'O Israel, can I not do to you as this potter has done to the clay? As the clay is in the potter's hand, so are you in my hand.'" Upon her return home that evening, she wrote all four stanzas before retiring for the night. Have thine own way, Lord. Let's rise and sing.
Fill with thy
Linton gave us just a few moments to pray for those things on our hearts, it's at this point that I'm inviting you to share those things that you would like us to pray for corporately this afternoon. Gordon. Thank you. We'll do that. Betty?
If you could pray for travelling mercies for me and Malcolm. We're going to a funeral in Sydney, and Malcolm really wanted to go. And as some of you know, Malcolm's a piece of work, so I'll hopefully 10 hours alone with him. Something might happen.
Where are you going to, Betty? Sorry? Mona Vale, right.
And we're both driving, and just pray that for our safety.
Yep. John. Thank you for those. There's a few other things that I've got on the list already. Phil mentioned the Everett Young Adult Group. They're on our month prayer sheet for this month, for today. So I'll be mentioning them. Mark's father, Les, has just had a stent put in, and he should be coming home tomorrow all right. Great to see Max and Dawn back with us after some absence, and we can be very thankful for that. But we'll continue to pray for Laurie Hockridge, Norma. Laurie's had a procedure, I think, yesterday. Don't know yet whether it's been done successfully, so we're still waiting to hear on that. All right, please join me as we... one other thing. Maybe mention it now, yes, as we love these sort of music. Then... Hymnfest, 27th of August, we've put it back from the 18th of June. So Hymnfest on the 27th of August, keep it in your diary. Jim. Thanks for that reminder. I know Eva isn't Jenny's granddaughter, but she's the daughter of a family in our church, and we will remember Eva too. Our Heavenly Father, as we thank you that you are interested in every one of us, every aspect of our lives. We thank you for the reminder that those things can change, and that we need to be listening to you at every point. And Father, this afternoon we have a list of things that we want to come to you with. Lord, it's not a shopping list, but it's just a reminder to us of these things which are important in your kingdom. And we pray, Lord, that you will hear us and answer our prayers. Father, we lift to you particularly our young adults, those who will follow us in this church, that you, if you bless them, our church will grow. If you are there with them in their services, binding them together in love, giving them a vision for their friends and colleagues, that through your word being gossiped around the community, their fellowship will grow too. Father, we've got some health issues amongst us. We're all getting old and a bit creaky. But Lord, we pray particularly for those who aren't with us at this time. We think of Les. We pray, Lord, that he'll make a speedy recovery from this procedure and that he'll be ready to come home tomorrow. Father, we pray for Laurie too, not quite the same procedure, but also concerning his heart. And we pray, Lord, that his pacemaker will be made to work perfectly so that his health will be restored and that he'll be able to continue as a great encourager for folk in our church. Father, we thank you that we see Max and Dawn back with us this afternoon. We pray, Lord, that you'll continue to bless them, their health, as Max has further procedure. We pray, Lord, that that will be successful and that there'll be no need for any more removal of cancer, that he'll be given the all clear. And Father, we pray for this young man, Tony, maybe not young, but reaching out to Gordon at this time from the men's shed. We thank you for the witness of that community there. And we pray, Lord, for Tony that as he reaches out, you'll touch his life and that he will come to see that Jesus died for him and he can receive salvation by believing that, understanding in his heart and being ready to accept that salvation is just a free gift because of your love. Father, I pray for Betty and her son Malcolm as they travel for this this funeral, that you'll give them safe journeys and an opportunity for serious and full conversation as they travel together over this period. We pray, Lord, that they'll be able to be encouragers, that Betty's heart for you will be shared, and that Malcolm will come to be encouraged and to know your grace and nearness. Father, we pray for Louise, John's daughter. Lord, she was part of our church as she grew up and for whatever reason has wandered away. But Lord, we pray that you will touch that young lady's life. We pray for their family as they not only suffer the cancer that she has, but also the COVID at this time, that you will just bring them through safely, that you will bless them with improved health. But also, Lord, we ask for a turning and a heart to turn to you and to return to you, that they might know your grace overflowing in their lives. And lastly, Lord, we bring to you this young girl, just 2 years old, threatened with losing her sight. Father, we bring her whole family to you, that they will hold fast, that they will be encouraged by your holding them through this difficult time. We pray, Lord, that you'll touch this little girl with your healing hand. We ask you, Lord, that these tumors will be removed, that they'll just disappear, that sight will be restored, that her health will be returned to her, that she'll be able to grow up as a normal young girl without this threat. But Lord, if that's not your will, we pray for her family, for acceptance, for even a rejoicing. Lord, we're conscious of many people who have lived victorious lives with such handicaps, such difficulties. And we thank you, Lord, that you are bigger than those things, that when our hearts condemn us, you are greater than our hearts. And we lift to you these families that are struggling at this time. Ask that you will touch them afresh. We thank you, Father, for hearing our prayers. We thank you, Lord, that you want to be part of our life with us. We ask, Lord, that we will just let you and rejoice in it. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Our final song is going to be Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing, a hymn written by Reverend Robinson, who penned the words in 1758, so it's not a new song. But he, at that time, was only 22 years old, so showed great perception. The lyrics, which dwell on the theme of divine grace, are based on 1 Samuel 7:12, in which the prophet Samuel rises a stone as a monument, saying, "Hitherto the Lord has helped us." The English translation of the name that Samuel gives to the stone is Ebenezer, meaning stone of help. The unusual word Ebenezer commonly appears in hymns and presentation of lyrics in verse 2 of this particular hymn. Various revised versions appear in the hymnals, often changing this phrase or replacing it, replacing the reference to Ebenezer. But the sentiment remains the same. Ebenezer, the stone of help. God has helped us to this point. Come thou fount of every blessing.
Thank you for being here this afternoon. We have afternoon tea up the back. You are welcome to stay and to discuss Phil's sermon with each other. Let me give thanks as we leave. Thank you, God, for being with us. Thank you for speaking to us. Give us open hearts to continue to hear what you whisper into our souls. In Jesus' precious name, amen. Mm-hmm.